Welcome to this lecture on Ministries and Departments, Introduction to the Lesson. The executive authority of the government is vested in the President. Article 53 of the Constitution says that the executive power of the Union shall be vested in the President and shall be exercised by him either directly or through officers subordinate to him in accordance with the Constitution. Thus, all the executive functions vested in the President are carried on in two ways. Number one, either directly by him, or number two, through subordinate officers. Article 53 authorizes Parliament to confer by law functions on authorities other than the President. Every law made by Parliament needs the assent of the President before it can become operative. But the Constitution has created a council of ministers to aid and advise the President in the exercise of his executive powers. Therefore, the President has to act as per the advice of the council of ministers. During the British rule, the Governor General in council took executive decisions. But when the work of the government increased, portfolio system was introduced by Lord Canning, in which each member of the council was assigned a particular portfolio. All matters concerning a particular portfolio were referred to the concerned member. The matters of general policy only were referred to the council. This practice continued after independence. The council became Council of Ministers or Cabinet. The Council of Ministers, although collectively responsible to the Parliament, had individual ministries or departments for which they were individually responsible to the Council of Ministers as well as to the legislature. The allocation of business. The Constitution has empowered the President to make rules for the convenient transaction of the business of the government and for its allocation among the ministers. The President, on the advice of the Prime Minister, allots ministries or departments to the ministers from time to time. The allocation of work is based on the Government of India Allocation of Business Rules 1961 as amended from time to time. These rules prescribe the ministries or departments, secretariat or office of the manner in which the work of the government is supposed to be carried out. The Government of India manual says the business allotted to a ministry is normally disposed of by the minister in charge or by an appropriate officer of the ministry under the direction of the minister. The exercise of the responsibilities by individual ministries is, however, subject to certain conditions, such as those requiring interdepartmental consultation in matters affecting the business allotted to another minister, or those requiring the submission of certain types of cases for the orders of the Prime Minister or the Cabinet or a committee of the Cabinet. Certain classes or cases are also required to be submitted to the President before issue of orders. Thus, for proper working of the government, a particular ministry is entrusted to a particular minister, subject to the overall control of the Prime Minister and the Cabinet. In the year 1947, the number of ministries were few, and ministries comprised of one department with one secretary. The work of the government has gradually increased due to planned economy and social welfare activities. Hence, the number of departments have also increased. But to contain the size of the Council of Ministers, it has become necessary to group a number of related departments into a single ministry. As a result, many ministries have now more than one department with a secretary as the head of each department. Basis of work distribution. The distribution of work among different departments is generally made on the following basis. Number one, functional basis, that is, functions to be performed. Number two, processes involved. Number three, people or clientele. Number four, area of operation. The actual allocation of work, however, is not based on any single criterion. In 1997, the executive work of the Government of India was divided into 38 ministries and 70 departments besides the Cabinet Secretariat, President's Secretariat, Prime Minister's Office, and the Planning Commission. The basis on which the division of work is made are given as follows. Basis of ministries or departments. Function, Defense Ministry. Education, Health and Family Welfare. Process, Law, Steel and Mines. Clientele Ministry of Women and Child Welfare and Ministry of Labor. Area of Operation, Ministry of Development of Northeast Region Area. Detailed allocation of work is given. The allocation of work between different ministries keeps on changing from time to time. Sometimes, the allocation for division of work is not based on any principle or basis, but only on political or personal consideration. Independent ministries or departments are carved out to accommodate some political leaders, as was done in the case of Ministry of Fertilizers and Chemicals in 1993. Sometimes, division of work is influenced by the considerations of weakening of some ministers. For example, when Y.B. Chavan was Home Minister, the CBI and IB and the Department of Personnel and Administrative Reforms were taken away from the Ministry of Home Affairs to weaken him. Likewise, Ministry of Agriculture has been cut to size by taking away Department of Rural Development, Fertilizers and Chemicals, etc. Thus, the division of work is not always based on rational considerations. Working of the ministries or departments. A ministry may consist of one or more departments, with each department under the charge of a secretary. Generally, a cabinet minister is in charge of a ministry, assisted by a number of ministers of state and or deputy ministers. Sometimes, the Minister of State may hold independent charge of a ministry. There are three levels which can be seen in the functioning of a ministry. 1. Political level, 2. Secretariat level, and 3. Executive level. The political head, the minister, the state minister, and the deputy minister are political persons who are in charge of a ministry. Sometimes, there may be parliamentary secretary at the bottom of political hierarchy. They occupy the position due to their political strength in the party. They are not experts or having any technical qualifications. The ministers broadly perform three types of functions. Firstly, they can initiate the broad policies for the department to follow. The minister decides all the important policy questions which may come up in the functioning of the department. Secondly, he exercises general supervision over the implementation of the policy by the department. Thirdly, he takes the responsibility of policies and administration of his department or ministry in the parliament. He answers parliamentary questions relating to his department. He pilots the legislation emanating from his department with the permission of the cabinet and also acts as representative of his department in the parliament as well as before the people. Finally, he represents his ministry in the cabinet. He has to share the collective responsibility of the cabinet to the parliament. The secretariat. The political head is supported by the secretariat of the department in the discharge of duties. The function of the secretariat is to provide expert advice for the formulation of policies. The secretariat is the central point of administration. For the smooth functioning, the department is further subdivided into various units. The scheme shows that the department is subdivided into wings, each headed by additional or joint secretary. Each wing is subdivided into divisions and is headed by a deputy secretary. A division is subdivided into branches, each headed by an under secretary, and a branch into sections, headed by a section officer. The functions and role of these officials are as follows. The secretary is the administrative head of the ministry or the department. He is the principal advisor to the minister on all matters of policy and administration of his ministry or department. He is fully responsible for the efficient administration of his ministry or department. He represents his ministry or department before the parliamentary committees on public accounts, estimates committee, and the committee on public undertakings, etc. He keeps himself informed of the working of his department by receiving weekly summaries that give the nature of cases that have been disposed of by his subordinate officers. He can issue instructions that certain cases may be submitted directly to him. Gopalaswamy Iyengar suggested a secretary should not be immersed in files and burdened with routine. It is essential that he should have time to grasp the overall picture, size up the problems facing government in the field allotted to his charge, and think and plan ahead. All these are his proper functions and must be efficiently performed. Failure to make adequate provision. The Administrative Reforms Commission has also visualized the role of the secretary primarily as one of coordinator, policy guide, reviewer, and evaluation. Thus, the secretary is at the top of departmental authority and draws the higher salary available to a number of IAS officers, special secretary. After independence, the original hierarchy has been disturbed by creating more than one level of authority. This undermines the solidarity, efficiency, and effectiveness of hierarchical organization. The post of special secretary is a good example of such disturbance of hierarchy. Ashok Chandra had pointed out in 1951 that a special secretary enjoying the pay, status, and authority of a secretary was appointed for a time to the Ministry of Agriculture. This was a unique post, and neither the principle on which such a post was created nor its relations with the permanent secretary were defined or appreciated. More recently, such a post has been revived in the Ministry of External Affairs to take charge of the administration of foreign service with the pay, rank, and status of a secretary. The Department of Heavy Industries in the Ministry of Commerce and Industry has also been placed in the charge of a special secretary, but with the pay of a joint secretary and with an undefined status. Additional secretary. Originally, the office next to the secretary was the deputy secretary, but in course of time, new levels of special or additional or joint secretaries were created. In 1937, the Organization and Procedure Committee referred to these new levels. Various committees asked to report on improvement in administration had adversely commented on the interposition of these levels between the secretary and the deputy secretary. There is no specific unit of administration of which an additional secretary is to be in charge. Sometimes he is given charge of a department and does the work of a secretary. At the other times, he heads the wing and performs the work of a joint secretary. Sometimes he helps the secretary in a specified field of activity. Richard Tottenham correctly narrated the nature and role of these posts. He says, "In my opinion, there should be no distinction of function, but only of pay, between a joint and additional secretary. They should only be required in those departments, and additional and joint secretaries should not be either chief secretaries or expensive deputy secretaries. The study team of the Administrative Reforms Commission on Personnel Administration and the ARC itself suggested for the creation of a definite level of additional secretary. It also envisaged cases in which a wing of the ministry may be headed by an additional secretary himself instead of a joint secretary. In the larger ministries, the level of additional secretary provides considerable relief to the secretary. In practice, however, the secretary sees in him a rival to his authority, and joint secretary finds in him an unnecessary interposition between themselves and the secretary. Joint secretary. The joint secretary is generally in charge of a wing, and he is vested with the maximum independence for functioning and responsibility of all business under his wing, subject to the general responsibility of the secretary for the administration of the ministry as a whole. According to A.D. Gorwala, the joint secretaries ought to, in reality, be what the name implies, namely, secretaries for the subject entrusted to them and joined to a more senior secretary for the convenience of administrative work. This post was created in early 1920s for three reasons. First, the increase in the function of some department made it difficult for one secretary to cope up with the increased work. Second, it was found difficult to combine separate items of business under one secretary to cope up with the increased work. And third, the emergence of two houses of legislature at the center in 1920, which necessitated the presence of senior officers in both the houses to assist the members in legislative work. The emergence of the post of joint secretaries between the secretary and his deputy secretaries has been criticized by almost all the committees appointed by the government to suggest improvements in the administrative machinery. The Gopalswamy Iyengar committee had called it an unsatisfactory arrangement, which caused delay and inefficiency. However, in practice, the joint secretaries are performing more or less the functions which the deputy secretaries used to perform earlier. Though they are in charge of the separate wing of the ministry, they function as deputies to the secretaries. They neither take any independent decisions nor do they submit files directly to the minister on the specific areas of work allotted to them. Deputy secretary. The deputy secretary is an officer who acts on behalf of the secretary. He holds charge of a secretariat division and is responsible for the disposal of government work under his charge. He should ordinarily be able to dispose of the majority of cases coming to him on his own responsibility. Originally, this officer occupied an important position, but after independence, the post has been devalued, and there are hardly any decisions which a deputy secretary takes on his own. He submits most of the cases to joint secretary. Undersecretary. An undersecretary is in charge of a branch in a ministry and exercises control both with regard to the discharging of business and maintenance of discipline. The role of this officer has been detailed in the Maxwell Committee report. The grade of the undersecretary should ordinarily initiate action on all inward communications immediately to the notice of the deputy secretary for any instructions which the latter might wish to give. The undersecretary should dispose of minor cases on his own volition. More important files he should submit to the deputy secretary in such a form that in ordinary course, the Deputy Secretary should be enabled to deal with the case quite briefly. Under secretaries should also attempt to reduce as far as possible the number of files to be formally submitted to the Deputy Secretary by taking the latter's verbal orders in appropriate cases. We consider that one of the great losses in recent years in the working of Secretariat Department is the practical disappearance due to various causes of the summary and draft of the efficient Undersecretary office. The Secretariat consists of two types of officers, one consisting of officers who take part in the decision-making process, and the other consisting of the office which maintains and presents papers. The functions of the office have been dealt with in the Secretariat. The office consists of the following grades of functionaries. Number 1, Section Officer. Number 2, Assistant. Number 3, Upper Division Clerk, that is UDC. Number 4, Lower Division Clerk, LDC, Typist, etc. Section Officer. The superintendents who are in charge of sections are called Section Officers. A Section Officer has to supervise the work of his staff in his section. He is responsible for handling important cases himself. He distributes the work among the staff, trains and advises them in the discharge of their duties. He coordinates the work of different functionaries in his section and ensures prompt disposal of work. He has to adopt proper methods for processing of cases, timely submission of statements and other periodical reports, proper maintenance of section diary, file, registers, assistants' diaries and other necessary papers and registers. He ensures compliance of instructions for secret papers. Assistants / upper division clerks. An assistant works under the order of the section officer and is responsible for the work assigned to him. His main functions are, first, to examine and put up suitable notes and drafts on cases quickly and submit them to the section officer after proper paging. Second, he has to maintain the assistant's diary, secure files and other registers and documents properly. Third, he has to keep papers and files in good condition. Some selected assistants may be authorized to submit cases directly to the branch officer. UDC generally performs similar functions to those of assistants, except that they are not required to deal with important cases. Lower division clerks or LDCs. These officers are ordinarily given work of a routine nature, such as registration of papers, maintenance of circulars and other registers, indexing, recording, preparation of arrear statements, typing, comparing and dispatch, etc. Attached offices. Besides the main secretariat, there are a number of attached offices at the headquarters of the Government of India. Such examples are the offices of the Controller of Printing, Chief Controller of Imports and Exports, Agricultural Marketing Advisor to Government of India, Directorate of Inspection, that is Income Tax, Chief Labor Commissioner, etc. Summary. The work of government increased due to planned economy and social welfare activities. Hence, the number of departments have also increased. But to maintain the size of the ministry small, it has become necessary to group a number of departments into a single ministry. As a result, many ministries have now more than one department with a secretary as the head of each department. Therefore, a minister now has more than one secretary to supervise. The functions of the government have become increasingly complex and multifarious. Therefore, in addition to the traditional departmental organizations, a number of other forms like company, corporations, etc. have come up to perform the governmental functions. The expansion of the business activities of the government has given birth to two new forms of organizations, government companies and statutory corporations. Briefly discuss the evolution of the secretariat in India. Write a note on the organizational structure of the Ministry of Home Affairs.